At the end of the last video, which was about the float field algorithm, I gave you a problem to think about, the number of islands problem. The problem says that we have a grid where a cell has the value 1 if it's land and 0 if it's water, and we want to count the number of islands. We define an island as an enclosed group of at least one cell of land surrounded by water or borders. For example, here we have 6 islands as you can see. Detecting an island is pretty easy to do for us as humans, because we can directly visualize an island, but it's not the case for a computer, which reads the grid cell by cell. Let's suppose that we're traversing the grid and we found a cell of land. It means that we found an island, so we increment the number of islands by 1. But the problem is that we can't just continue traversing, because once we find another cell that belongs to the same island, we'd also increment the number of islands, which is wrong because we counted the same island twice. So, to avoid this problem, as soon as we find a new island, we increment the counter, but we also mark all the cells of that island as visited, so that the next time we find a cell that belongs to that island, we'll be able to know that we should not increment because we did it before. Okay, but the question is, how to mark all the cells of an island as visited? An island is a connected group of land cells, and in the last video, we've seen how to fill the cells of a connected area by using the flood fill algorithm. So we will use the flood fill algorithm every time we find an unvisited cell, and this is what happens. If you didn't watch the last video and you don't know how the flood fill algorithm works, I really suggest you to watch it to be able to understand what just happened now. Now, we can move to the code. You will see that the code of this solution is pretty easy. We have the function nbislands that takes the grid as a parameter. It creates a counter initialized to 0, then it loops over cells by using nested for loops. The outer one for the rows and the inner one for the columns. I represents the actual row and G the actual column. And for each cell, if it's equal to 1, then it's an unvisited cell, because 0 is for water and 2 for visited cells. And we said that when we find an unvisited cell, it means that we found a new island. This is why we increment the counter and we call the flood fill function to mark the cells of that island as visited by giving them the value 2. Know that we can't choose a value that is different from 2, it just has to be different from 1. After the loop, we just return the counter. Now, try to find the time complexity of this function, knowing that we said in the last video that the time complexity of the flood fill algorithm is O of n times m. You probably answered O of n times m squared, because we have an outer loop that does n iterations, an inner loop that does m iterations, and an O of n times m algorithm inside it. So we have n times m times n times m, which gives n times m squared. But n times m squared is not the tight upper bound, let me tell you why. The case where the flood fill function costs n times m happens only in the worst case, when the whole grid is one big connected area. But in a general way, we consider the time complexity of the flood fill function as O of uppercase n, where uppercase n is the number of cells of the area to be filled, the surface of an island in our case. And because all of our islands belong to the same n by m grid, then the sum of their sizes can't exceed n times m, this is why we get a time complexity of O of n times m. Space complexity is also of n times m because of the flood fill function that has an O of n times m space complexity. That's it for this video. If you had to retain two things from this one, the first one would be that the more you know algorithms, the more you'll be able to solve different problems. For example, we could easily solve this one because we already know the flood fill algorithm, and we could detect that we can use it for our situation. The second thing would be that analyzing the time and space complexity of an algorithm isn't always easy and straightforward. You need to use some logic and reasoning, and you also need to know how is your algorithm working. And speaking of time and space complexity analysis, I recently made a complete course on the subject. The link is in the description. I hope that you enjoyed this video, like and subscribe, and see you in the next one.